for their contribution in the field of vortex physics with a prize in his honor, in the honor of Alexei Abrikosov. So our ceremony consists in two short speeches and the handing of the commemorative plaques to the winners. So the first short speech will be made by Professor Valery Vinokur. He'll tell us about some reminiscences of Alexei Abrikosov. Please, the floor is yours.
Well, in 10 minutes, it's too hard to give like full account of what Alexei Alexeyevich did in his life, what were his works, and like, okay, to give full appreciation of his like giant figure. So I'll try to go in a little bit in sequence of disordered reminiscences. This, I believe, is a good title for this short speech. Well, Abrikosov was indeed outstanding scientist and more than outstanding. We know all about Abrikosov vortex lattice. What people now know a little bit less is that actually he redid all the condensed matter physics theory of galvanomagnetic phenomena and many other things. Well, people who were getting the education in Russia know what was called Green Book. This was our basic textbook on the field methods in statistical physics and condensed matter theory. Actually, it was a collection of the works made by sisters and glue of these three outstanding authors. And basically, Abrikosov was one of the creators of the modern condensed matter theory. It was even more interesting thing, which came to me a little bit as a surprise. About 1992, we had a Targan visit, a visitor from Russia, one of the leading high energy physicists. We had a private, like small party at our place. We had dinner, and he said that, well, we're talking about different things, and he said what a smart idea was invite and hire Abrikosov to Argon, but he was a little bit surprised, as he put it, that Abrikosov was hired by material science division. Then it was my turn to be surprised, and I asked, okay, where else? And he said, high energy physics, for example. How come? And then I found out that my eminent visitor and guest actually knew nothing about vortex lattice. Basically, he knew very few things about condensed matter physics, and yet he just told me that Abrikosov's name is completely immortal. And he quoted his work together with Halatnikov on asymptotic freedom in quantum electrodynamics, saying that this work completely changed the way people were thinking about this science and just qualified him as a genius. This was quite interesting for me. To realize what kind of outstanding figure he was in science. Well, many of the people who sit here know him personally and know well that he was outstanding personality, but he was not a sweet person or Santa Claus or anything like that. He was sometimes, and quite often, tough. But in any case, yeah, there are a lot of stories. Some of them are quite funny, and maybe later on we all three together will remember a couple of more of the stories which are funny. But there were a few which I would like, okay, to tell you about. One of them is well known but not appreciated, and another one is just my personal experience. It is just the stories which show him as a person, okay, with a perfect match of his genius, scientific genius. One of them is indeed well known because it's published. It is his work, it is his work where he advertised his vortex lattice. There is a part in this work where he gives the full account and gives respectful and adequate reference to Shubnikov's work, who actually discovered what sometimes people now call Shubnikov phase, now we call it more often the Bricosov phase. But I don't think that many of us do appreciate what actually does it mean to give this reference. If you will be rereading original paper by Landau and Ginzburg and Landau, where they introduced Ginzburg-Landau equation, there is a very interesting passage written in a very strange way about the possibility of the existence of what now we call type 2 superconductors. I don't want to retell it now, but it reads really strange. And those who knows a little bit the history, we know that definitely at that time Landau knew about this Shubnikov phase and the possibility of the existence of type 2 superconductors. But in 1950, to refer to Shubnikov, who was executed in 1937, would have been a suicide. But in 1957, it was not quite clear, because the sentence to Shubnikov was not dismissed at that time, and he was still considered a criminal, and give the reference of the kind which Bricosov did in his work. It was an action, strong action of a very brave, and a very brave man. Not everybody was capable, to do things like that. Another story of the same kind, it's more personal. Just at the verge of perestroika, agonizing Soviet power decided to shut down one of the best mathematical school in Moscow. It was considered to be elitarian, but elitarian of the wrong kind, because it was not the kids of party, high party officials who were selected there, but talented kids. So it was made an attempt to just shut it down for absolutely false pretension that the building needs some repair. And people who were concerned developed strong activity to prevent this disastrous action. And one of the ideas was that if some eminent scientists write a letter to the party secretary, this could help to stop this action. Actually, it was a success. The school was not shut down. And, well, Misha Figelman and myself, we composed such a letter. And we, well, selected two scientists who should sign this letter. The name of one of them I will not give out, because my unfortunate theoretical prediction was that he will never sign this letter, and he did not. And then I turned to Abrikosov. Well, Misha was busy, so I went to Abrikosov alone. Abrikosov very attentively read this letter, took the pen, and slightly edited it. After his edition, this letter became at least 10 times stronger. After that, we found the typist in Kapitsa Institute, actually Abrikosov found. The letter was retyped, he signed it, and I sent it. Well, we will never know how much it helped, but probably it did. And it was another action of a brave man who is quite capable to act. How much time do I have? Or I am done. Okay, well, there is one more thing which probably formed his character. And I don't know how many people know about his family and where he is coming from. Who knows? Okay. Yeah, so his father, academician Alexei Ivanovich Abrikosov, was one of the stars of Soviet pathologists. He was the person who was responsible for embalming Lenin's body, for example. And his grandfather probably is known even better than his father, because Abrikosov is coming from the family of one of the bigger Russian industrialists, and one of their responsibilities was supplying of the imperial court by chocolate. So it was quite a wealthy family. And this probably sort of formed his character. Because, well, all the Soviet physicists, they signed sort of agreement with the devil. But Abrikosov, was always positioning himself not as a person who is taking a charity. He was high enough to believe that he's not getting what he deserves by this agreement. And therefore, he didn't feel that he is obliged to honor this agreement with the devil. And at first opportunity, he left this country, and probably many of you know that when he was receiving Nobel Prize the first evening, when it was a party in the University of Chicago, he was wearing a tie of an American flag, and just to make sure that everybody noticed it, he made the proper statement that he is happy to be an American. And that he is happy not to deal with the country. He could never believe that this country changed even after the perestroika. So he was again, I probably have to stop now. He was a giant figure. As I said, not every time a sweet person, but he was a personality capable for action in science and in other facets of our life. And as a person like that, he is calling for enormous respect, not only for his scientific genius, but also for his personality, big personality. Okay, at this I would like to stop.
Thank you very much, Valerie, for bringing your reminiscences of Alexei Abrikosov. Now I call Professor Alexander Gurevich to tell us about the Abrikosov Prize of this year, 2017. Please, the floor is yours.
So it gives me a great pleasure to introduce a new Abrikosov Prize winners, Misha Feigelman, Gianni Blatter, Dima Geshkin-Bain, and Valery Vinokur, for their outstanding contribution to what we now call vortex matter, the theory of vortex matter. And this task is both very difficult and easy because everybody knows them. And now what they did was, it's now indispensable to the modern theory of vortex matter. However, I don't think that many people, particularly young people sitting in this room, really appreciate what has been done. Because for them, it's obvious, it's sure, it's there. What else can it be? In reality, it was exactly the opposite, because when IDCQ plates were discovered, it turns out that the behavior of Q plates was completely very different from what we know from the conventional Abrikosov physics. Basically, the Abrikosov lattice was regarded as a sequence of rods influenced by magnetic field and temperature, but that was it. So it was a fixed lattice. And Larkin Ovchinnikov collective pinning theory taught us that actually pinning can strongly distort that lattice, and the lattice can be pinned collectively. However, the temperature in terms of fluctuations was regarded negligible for a very simple reason. A line tension of an Abrikosov vortex in conventional materials is about 1,000 or 10,000 Kelvin per nanometer. That means that thermal energy is negligible and it can't produce any visible or essential bending distortions of the vortex. So basically, you can consider vortices as rods, and that was it. What was realized shortly after discovery of IDC cuprates was that actually line tension of vortices in cuprates is strongly reduced by low carrier density or superfluid density and strong anisotropy. And that reduces line tension by 2-3 orders of magnitude. Suddenly, temperature becomes very important because now you have strongly fluctuating vortex lines. And then people sitting in this front row realized very quickly how to build a theory which incorporates this very complicated and very interesting vortex matter in terms of interacting strongly fluctuating vortex lines. So then, of course, immediately people recognized the importance of giant flux creep, irreversibility field, which can be much smaller than the upper critical field, particularly in anisotropic cuprates. So then the heroic period of vortex physics started, and there have been lots of breakthrough developments, starting from the theory of collective flux creep by Feigelman, Geshkin-Bain, Larkin, and Vinokur, followed by the theory of quantum creep by Blatter, Geshkin-Bain, and Vinokur, and then things progressed really quickly. And turns out that all this work was strongly coupled with experiment. So there was a very unusual positive feedback between theory and experiment. Basically, theorists were suggesting experiments either proved or disproved the models, and that really intensified our understanding of what is called Borg's matter. Lots of things were discovered at the time, Borg's melting, a very handy method of when you can map the behavior of strongly an isotropic superconductor in basically isotropic superconductor was very efficient because it would allow us to calculate lots of non-trivial effects of anisotropy. Then it was recognized that vortices can be mapped on some effective 2D Bose system in which the Z coordinate plays a role of time, and that resulted in what is called Bose glass by Nelson and Vinokur. People who sit here actually has done a lot, and I can't even list all these important works, but thanks to them, we now have what is called now a theory of Borg's matter. And that gives me a great pleasure to congratulate new laureates. Thank you.
Thanks, Alex, for this description of the work done by the prize winners of this year. Now, I would like to call the first prize winner, Professor Jenny Blatter, and Professor Silvio Quezado to hand the plaque. Professor Silvio Quezado is the Deputy Director of the International Institute of Physics. Next, I would like to call Bill Feitgen, the representative of our sponsors, the sponsors of the Abrikosov Prize, and the prize winners, Dr. Mikhail Feigelman and Dr. Vadim Geshkenvai, who will receive the prize on behalf of Professor Mikhail Feigelman, who could not be here. And lastly, I would like to call Professor Eli Zeldov, the chairman of the selection committee, to hand the commemorative plaque to Professor Valery Vinokur. So the ceremony is closed, and you are all invited to come to dinner.